All right, everybody, we'll get going. We understand that the three of us are kind of in a tough spot right now. We are sitting here 25 minutes between you and happy hour. So I do think that this is going to be a really interesting panel. The two gentlemen here have two different perspectives, and I think you'll enjoy hearing both of them. So we're here to talk about smart buildings, and let's start by introducing yourselves first. Jeff?
All right. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Jeff Fronick. I'm the Director of Investments at Rubenstein Partners. We're an office-focused real estate private equity firm based out of Philadelphia, but with offices across the eastern U.S. We manage about $2 billion of AUM across equity and debt strategies exclusively in office. I also, in addition to sort of working across regions on the acquisition, more front end of our business, I oversee two of our developments here in New York City. The first is the first Class A office building to come to market in Williamsburg called 25 Kent. That'll be delivering very shortly this year. We're extremely excited about it. And the second will be a follow-on phase two of sorts, which is a partnership with Acme Smokefish. So both sort of a mixed-use commercial, mixing manufacturing as well as office and retail all under one roof.
Hi. Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Jan-Hein Lakerman, and I'm the Managing Director of Edge Technologies here in the US. We are, from origin, we are a Dutch-German office developer, investor, and operator, but especially of very smart and sustainable office buildings. One of our buildings you might know, it's called The Edge in Amsterdam, and it became the most sustainable building in the world in 2014. It still is one of the most sustainable buildings in the world. But it became very famous because it was also very smart, according to the people from Bloomberg that came over and made a tremendous documentary about it. And that's why how we became famous, or world famous, if you will, in Europe. And now we're also trying to make those edge buildings here in the US. The main driver behind it, and it's actually quite easy to tell, we think that the world needs better buildings. And why is that? That's because we believe that if you're active in the commercial real estate, or if you're active in real estate at all, you have a moral obligation to do something about the fact that we are the contributors of about 40% of the CO2 exhaust that is going on in the world. Secondly, we also see in the office world that the majority of the office users nowadays are not engaged in their working because the buildings don't cater to their needs. And we have a whole philosophy behind that, and it's around four pillars on how we make those better buildings, and they're centered around sustainability, well-being, user-centered design, and they're all driven by tech. And I would look forward to share some of our experiences on those fields with you guys.
Thank you. My name is Greg Fryant. I'm with Connectivity Wireless. I'm the moderator for this panel. And Jan-Hein jumped ahead a little bit, but you know, we're here to talk about smart buildings. And there's a wide definition, almost an ambiguous definition of what a smart building is. So I'm going to ask you guys from two different perspectives, what is your definition of what a smart building is?
Sure. So I think smart building is that term is certainly a buzzword. It's in transition. It seems to mean something different perhaps every day. And I think it really depends on, you know, our focus at Rubenstein is on being customer centric. And so it really depends on the market and on the needs of the customers. If you have a call center in, in Fort Mill, South Carolina, that's gonna be a different sort of customer who you were trying to deliver for than, you know, in Brooklyn here in New York City. So I think, though, what is why we're all here talking about it is that the ceiling has been raised dramatically, and what the technology that's being able to be leveraged within a real estate context is, you know, there's new ground that's broken every day. So some of the things that we're looking into at 25 Kent is public Wi-Fi, a lot of the LEED sustainability features that Jan-Hein was talking about. Building app, so you know when someone comes in the morning, the building will know who that person is. That person will their sort of experience is managed through an application. You know, checking in instead of having to register guests downstairs, they'll make a reservation or register those people online. And this is all part of a sort of a service-oriented repositioning. And so people today are demanding more across the board. The nature of work is changing, which I'm sure we'll get into in another question. And that is what sort of these problems that are unlocking opportunities, which is sort of resulting in smarter buildings.
I guess we all have to sit down. It's we think smart technologies are enormously interesting in our field, especially in our old-fashioned real estate industry. I believe that we are dead last when it comes to how we have disrupted our industry compared to any other industries. I think agriculture is maybe a little bit ahead of us, and it's just a bloody shame. But it's not only that. So not only that you have to be disruptive in order to make a smart building and use a sensor and maybe, you know, have an app or something. We really see smart buildings as an holistic approach. And I already emphasized it a little bit when we say that we don't only see smart tech as a tool. It's really an enabler to make buildings that are sustainable. In our case, we even make our buildings energy neutral. The edge in Amsterdam is it. We made one here in the US as well for Unilever. That's also creating more energy than its needs. We strongly believe that well-being is an enormous factor. How can you make sure that in those buildings people are ill in a lesser way, or in a case are more productive? We are close to scientifically prove that people actually are more productive in our buildings. Very interesting, because then you have a different discussion with the tenant. You don't talk about rent anymore. You talk about how can you maybe share in the profits. And lastly, it's really about the user. So what we try to do is make a stacking plan in our buildings that we make sure that the people in our buildings remain engaged. Co-working is a component. Studios are components, amenity spaces. We love atria, where people bump into each other. So I think the answer is that we see smart buildings as a holistic view of sustainability, well-being, user-centered design, and the technology comes as an enabler, and it comes last. We love to make computers with a roof on it, we always say.
It leads to an easy follow-up question is, how do you measure that? I mean, you both have two different perspectives. One is, correct me if I'm wrong, tenant-driven. The other is landlord-driven, is of how you develop that smart building. But how do you measure, have you achieved what you've set out to do?
Yeah, so that's the fun thing about smart technologies. You can quantify stuff. So a couple of examples. In the case of the Edge in Amsterdam, Deloitte is one of our main tenants. And this building enables them to work in this space with 3,400 people, while they only utilize 1,200 desks. And then you say, then they're probably neck and neck together or like sardines in one space. No, the building is never full. And why is that? Is that because smart tech, and in this case, the apps, allow those people to use the space in a way that the building tells them where to sit based on their agenda. So it's actually the building gets better in the course of the usage of the building, and it gets better like good wine, if you will. And I think that's one thing. So data allows you to quantify and have a good discussion, not only with the CFO, because he loves it because he needs lesser square footage, but the HR person also likes it because we see things from the app that people are more productive and more busy and doing more things than they would used to do in their older buildings. I think that's one tool. Another tool is how can you make sure that also, again, maybe on focusing on costs. In the case of Unilever, again, the building I emphasized before, this is a campus-style building with four building components, and we can see how the building is used in the course of a week. And what we told Unilever is that based on our findings on Wednesday afternoons and on Friday afternoons, the building was used in a lesser way. And we told them, maybe you want to shut down certain floors or certain areas, and you can tell the people through the app where to go. This is what they're doing now. So have people bump into each other and more. They can shut down certain floors. That saves you in energy, but also in cleaning costs and in security costs, etc. And smart tech and a smart building allows you to measure those kind of things in a very good way.
Yeah. So, look, I think Jan, I've hit the measurement piece of this very well, and this is being I think in terms of where technology is being implemented within office buildings, it's across the board now, and one of the most impactful ways is on the operations side. And I think that really taking that comment one step further is not just sort of looking at the data, but how do you implement the data and how do you reap the benefits of the data? And that's where, candidly, I think that sort of the benefits are not easily accessed in a lot of situations that may sort of oversell the promise of some of the things that we're talking about. So office tenants are on 15-year, you know, long-term leases. So how do they reduce square footage overnight? I think there's certainly some opportunities, flexible work place providers, but you know, how do you give back square footage and appease a CFO? Your security costs, if you darken a floor for one day a week, you're still gonna have the same security costs. Another type of security is all obviously cybersecurity and internet security. So a lot of the pushback that we've seen from large occupiers has been, that's very nice that you have, you're monitoring usage, you want us to integrate within your system as the landlord, but you know, we are Facebook or whoever, and we don't want, our system needs to sit independently of your system. And so I do think that the best applications in many ways are these sort of single tenant buildings like Unilever, where it's sort of a build to suit situation where the company I think is a little bit less cost sensitive and a little bit more interested in the story. They're a visionary, they buy into this, and sort of they can wrap everything under one roof, and therefore they're reaping more of the benefits. On a sort of speculative third-party basis, I think there's some real challenges.
So it's interesting, in the last two answers, both you guys touched on something that is probably important to everybody in this room, and that's money. And Jonheim, I'd like to come back to you, and in your answer before, something that caught my attention was you said when you build a building, some of your tenants want to reap some of the benefits, the financial benefits. Did I understand that correctly? Could you expand on that? Because I'd be curious, I mean, what type of arrangements do you put together with your tenants where you share that?
Yeah, so I think the biggest misconception currently, even in this market, is that it's more expensive to go into a smart building. I think we've proven, not only in Europe, where of course we're a little bit ahead of the curve when it comes to those concepts than we are here, but also here we've proven that you can make a smart and very sustainable building in a multi-tenant situation while not being more expensive than a typical high-performing building that you would see here in New York, for instance. Now, how can we do that? It's because of a couple of ways. In the case of Unilever, I think, the best example is that we made sure that we solved the split incentive problem for them. And the split incentive problem is something called that basically the one that invests into sustainability or in smart tech doesn't always get it back. Now, in this case, we said from day one, you're going to get it back. Because what happens? We told them that we needed maybe a slightly increase in the rent, and you're talking about, you know, single-digit percentage points. But we promised, again, in the form of a green lease, an offset with lower operational cost, and we guaranteed that going forward by a double-digit decrease of operational costs. So, a long story short, we promised them a better building for a lower price from a total cost of ownership perspective, and we guaranteed that. And it's working. The building is open now for a year, and it's actually performing better than it was anticipated. Sorry. The funny thing was, is that smart tech was the driver behind it, because we can really quantify what is going on in this building. And as said, we offered them even more savings because we saw that the usage of the building was different, which is always the case, than what was anticipated. And then smart tech is an enabler to have a quantifiable discussion with your users, how you then go and share those rewards or maybe even get a higher rental price going forward. In our multi-tenant situations, we are able now to get higher rents from a net perspective, but also from a gross perspective, factoring in those lower operational costs. So two examples really quick.
No, thank you. And Jeff, what are some of the misconceptions with smart buildings? What are some of the, I don't know if I'm going to say resistance, but what are some of the misgivings that come up when you start talking about smart buildings?
Sure. So, well, I think the number one question is, why don't we have more buildings like the Edge? And I do think that, I mean, not throwing down the gauntlet too hard, but I do have some questions about the costs and premiums and whatnot, because we do see, you know, we're looking at energy neutral building in new development in Raleigh. We're looking at buildings in different markets. One Bryant Park collects its own rainwater, is LEED Platinum, significant cost increase premium over comparable like-kind buildings. So that would be interesting to get to the bottom of. But I guess the I think the first misgiving is like, why don't we have more? Because where the costs are justified, they're clearly superior in terms of design, in terms of wellness of the occupants, and that's something that, you know, and in terms of sustainability. I think one of the biggest issues with real estate development are the resources that are consumed. The reason why there aren't more is probably the first misconception. That's because there are a lot of mediocre operators, and that I think have gotten away with mediocrity for a long time. The cost to retrofit an existing building is probably far surpasses the costs, especially when factoring the benefits of sort of having that opportunity to build and implement in a clean slate, a blank slate rather. And I think in terms of like, if the question was more geared towards what's the misconception in terms of why aren't there more? Or why hasn't this happened across the board? I think it's also, you know, you have different stakeholders who have to buy into this. The CFO up front, at least, I mean, most of them are going to look predominantly at the rent, because they're going to say, you're offering me, you know, cost savings over time, but all I know is the rent. And there may be some visionaries, but by and large, probably not as many. And also, it's just, it's very, very hard to get it right. I mean, there's so many instances where you're implementing, you know, how many software implementations have different companies gone through that are complete disasters? You even saw this on, you know, not to be venture too far out of real estate, but on the electronic health record. I mean, there were several multi-billion-dollar valued companies, and really only one of them has persevered over time, because it's just very, very hard to get an integrated system done right.
Jan-Heim, would you mind expanding on that?
Yeah, definitely. And I think that we could have a debate on how expensive an item is, and I think you don't want to get there. What is interesting is that smart buildings, and when holistically seen, so when you add that well-being component, if you do that right, and it's been done all over the world, it's even been done here in New York, if you can have a good discussion with your client about the benefits of such a smart building. And again, if you can increase productivity, if you can reduce illness rates, the dollars that are talking about those items or involved in those items are far beyond the rental discussion of, you know, 5 to 10% higher or lower rents. And that is a discussion that you want to enter into. And that's been done all over the world. Well-being, that part. Smart tech as a driver. I think it is making a smart building is a real combination of a lot of factors. And there's no one-stop shop, because factors like the path of the sun are of influence. How much solar panels you can use in an inner city location. Those are also things that are big factors. I think it's making a smart building is a real creative puzzle that you have to make with 1,000 pieces, and it's also got to do with an open mindset.
So we're almost out of time with the last question. Let me throw you guys a curveball and short amount of time to answer this. Smart buildings have really grown a lot in the last few years. Where do you see, if you had a crystal ball, where do you see smart buildings going? Jeff, do you want to answer first?
Sure. Yeah, I think we're very much only getting started. I think real estate is undeniably a laggard in, you know, across the board for technological innovation. You've seen in the last couple of years the curve of funding going into real estate tech and into prop tech and the innovation skyrocket. I mean, I think with the edge, there is proof of concept finally that sort of a full-scale smart building, you know, works. They've gotten all the publicity that they deserve for that. I think this is also, you know, there has to be a product market fit, and the market has never been more ripe to be receptive to, you know, whether it's smart buildings or technology in buildings, whatever you want to call it. You look at IBM's sort of path of real estate decisions where, you know, they use their legacy headquarters was 590 Madison. That was, you know, people come in, they commute into the city, they go upstairs at 9 a.m., they eat in the cafeteria, they go downstairs at 5, and they go back out to the suburbs. Now they have a massive presence downtown at 51 Astor Place. It's not cubicles, it's not offices, it's all open, it's all collaborative. It's all about social interaction and well-being. So I think that's where we're focused on the real estate developments that we are currently pursuing and constructing are after those models. And we're very excited to see what the future will bring, because in our mind, it's all about how can we improve the tenant's experience, and that's what people value today.
I think I would have two answers for that, which is a medium-term answer and a long-term answer. We believe on the medium term that 5G will be a tremendous opportunity. Combining all the items in your building that can have an internet connection with each other. So for instance, that the coffee machine recognizes you in the morning, and that's when you have a cappuccino, but based on your preferences, after your heavy lunch on Friday, you'll get a double espresso. And so those are just things out of convenience, and that will make your life in a building more enjoyable. So making 5G, utilizing 5G in how you use a building, that will offer us tremendous opportunities. Long term, and it's been done, but we see that there's a big, even bigger future for that, and it's going to take a little bit longer. But in the end, we see a complete circular world when it comes to our office buildings. So if you look at a building like this, it's all concrete, it's all steel, and it's all, well, you cannot at the moment reuse concrete. In the future, and this is what we're doing now with our second generation edge buildings, we're giving those buildings a passport. So the future owners, when they try to, well, give a different use for this building 40 years after completion, it knows, or they know, what type of items, what type of materials we've used where, and how they can reuse that in a different building 40 years from now. So circularity is going to be a big driver behind the smart buildings of the future. That's what we strongly believe.
Well, thank you very much. It's 4:55, Mario. I want to thank these gentlemen for all of their input, and I think that's it.